Well, we know everything is right in the world when we see this guy. That's what I was hoping for. Some sort of theatrics. That's the man. Good to see you, Jaw. We have a field trip today together. Days with Jordan the Lion begins now. What's up, guys? Days with Jordan the Lion. Getting the day started. I think I know what I'm going to do today. I think I'm going to go to Orange County and hang out with Breck because I heard that the girl who was in Annie, like the version that my sister and I used to watch when I was a kid, she has a band and they're playing at like downtown Disney tonight. Breck works at Disney, so I think he can just get us into the park and everything without having to pay for parking and all that stuff and check it out. I think it's like a big band kind of thing or something. I just thought it'd be kind of cool to see. Like, she was very memorable. Like, for me, she will always be the Annie. Like, she's exactly who I picture. I always thought she was adorable when I was a kid. And since he lives in Orange County, I'm going to go do a few other things and take you guys along with. I think you guys will have a lot of fun. I tried to film something extra for since I have to work tomorrow. And, man, I was using my video camera, and it just didn't. It was giving me motion sickness watching it. Something just wasn't right. Plus, you know, I'm encountering every time I use that thing, I have a little like steadying device on it, and one of the problems that I'm having is it makes the thing so big that then people stop and they start watching me, and then I got people standing in the shot, and plus it's just too hard and awkward to vlog with. So I think what I'm gonna do is I think I might try and go trade it in at the camera store for something a little bit more appropriate for vlogging. I've been doing some research and I think I found a camera that it might be a little bit better for me. You know, that the camera I have, it's good for a lot of things, but for what I'm doing, it's just not working out too well. It's unfortunate, but like I said, the thing ends up becoming so big in your hand that then people stop and they want to know what you're doing. They're listening, and then it's hard to like turn it around and vlog myself and stuff like that. So, like I said, I think I'm just better off looking at this Sony XR100 Mark V. It's apparently got a built-in wide-angle lens and all that stuff, and they say it's great for vlogging. So, and it's like the size of a cell phone, which is good. The other problem is my camcorder, the Canon, it doesn't take good photos. And a lot of reviews talked about that. And since I'm going to be going to Sweden, I want to be able to take photos. And this Sony basically takes professional style photographs. So that's why I'm leaning towards it. But we're going to head off to Orange County and have some fun. Let's go. This is pretty typical LA traffic. 12:30 on a Friday. I'm going to Breck's. He lives about 40 miles away from me. And it's an hour and 25 minute drive, according to my GPS. Oh, so I forgot to even mention why I brought up the camera situation. Because I know I have other vloggers that watch my vlogs. You guys know how I do my vlogs and what I'm using it for. If any of you have any experience with this Sony camera that I'm looking at, let me know what your opinions are of it, or any drawbacks you might think I might have with it before I go spending some of my tax return money on it. Appreciate it. We are definitely not in LA anymore. We are in the gated confines of Orange County. It looks like Jaws found the turtle. Breck's pet turtle that's older than Breck, probably. Not too camera friendly. He keeps turning away from me. Not quite like that guy. All right, well, we're back in the car. And what I decided to do, since we're down in Fullerton, basically, is show you guys a little bit of the Fender history. Fender guitars. I mean, probably my favorite job that I had as a kid growing up was when I was in high school. I got to work for the music store that I had always taken lessons from. Everything from vocal lessons to guitar lessons. And then one day, the guy who owned the store, it was called Sound City Music, he moved locations, and I offered to help renovate the place when he moved in, and he never forgot it. And one day he called me and offered me a job. And his main stock was all Fender stuff. So Fender has a really soft spot in my heart. And just the Fender history down here is amazing. Especially since we just talked about Les Paul kind of creating
the first solid body guitar, Leo Fender was the first one to mass produce it.
Mark said these are orange groves because the building behind it used to be sun-kissed. Well, right over here at the train station, they've created something interesting for old Leo Fender. They've put these little murals up at this parking garage. We're gonna go over and take a closer look. Now I'm gonna save it for next time I come, but the Fullerton Museum Center has a whole exhibit on Leo Fender. Now the reason I think that they put this here is because Leo Fender, in a lot of ways, actually put Fullerton on the map. He started his whole electronics shop in 1945, but when he started making Fender guitars, every single Fender guitar was stamped with Made in Fullerton. Fullerton, California was stamped on every single one. Now this parking garage, what's interesting about this is that this was the site of where his original factory was. From 1946, when he actually was really starting to take orders for these mass-produced Telecasters and precision basses, which the very first ones would have been made right here on this property, if you can believe that. He started out with one building in 1945, and then in 1946, it was starting to grow. What he was doing was hand-making the instruments, basses, and Telecasters, which now are the most widely copied instruments by other companies there are. But when he started making those here, he was also doing like home car, like car installations, putting it, like he was doing various electronical things. It wasn't just a full-time Fender thing at that point. And then somehow it started to grow, and in 46 he put two metal buildings out here and this brick one out here, and it just took up the whole, basically the whole block. And this is where they, where the Fender company would stay making these beautiful guitars and basses and amplifiers from 1945, 46 until basically they outgrew the place in 1953. And we're gonna take off from here and we're gonna go over to where his original electronic shop was. Before there was Fender Fine Electrical Instruments, there was this place. Now we're heading over to the, what was the start of it all? The Fender Radio Shop. And this was where Leo started it all in the early 40s. He was servicing appliances, musical instruments, he was selling instruments, fixing amplifiers, and this is where he would start working on the guitar. Now, we just saw where he mass produced these. That was the first factory. And now we're gonna see where he first started tinkering with the idea of mass produced solid body guitars and basses. Old timey bike. Just passed by this historic building. And it's a Bourbon Street bar, and I noticed they had this whole mural on the side. I thought that was pretty cool. Now it looks like right there at that Ellingson, that looks like that's where that would have been. Let's go take a look. Right there. So it looks like, and I didn't know this, it looks like he had both places at the same time. He would have had this shop going at the same time that he had the factory going, because the factory we saw was in 1946. Pretty cool. Wow, what a piece of history. I came around to the back of that building because I had read that there was a mural back here by a lady named Catherine England, and there sure is. But what I didn't realize was that it's a mosaic Wow, look at this thing. Somebody, it looks like people have broken off little chunks or it's broken somehow right there. But check that out. Wow, look at that. Even got a whammy bar on there, right there. That is so cool. And the hands even kind of mosaic-y. And that's cool, look. With a little help from my friends. This totally makes the trip worth it, because for all the things that aren't here anymore of the Fender legacy, just seeing that somebody put in the time to do this right where it all started is so cool. Check that out. That is awesome. God, it's just so cool. Isn't that something, Brooke?
Yeah, that's amazing.
Tails down on like the input jack and stuff. They got the sparkliness of the input jack, and even the fretboard's got a glaze to it. So cool. Historic ballroom, huh? Wonder what the history is behind that. Pretty crazy. Leo Fender was pretty much raised in Fullerton and went to Fullerton High School. And yet he was buried in Santa Ana. I don't know. Now this is awesome. This to me is just, I had to see this, and this had to be our last stop, because this is basically our last stop on our Fender tour today. This was, once Leo Fender and the whole Fender company started gaining traction and it got bigger than what he could do with those two metal buildings where he had started, he moved over here. And this, from 1953 until 1985, was the factory that produced all of the Fender guitars. So you might just say, well, it's a factory, so what? Well, the guitar that Buddy Holly would have been playing in 1957, 1958, 1959 would have been made here. Jimi Hendrix guitars would have been made here. Eric Clapton's guitars would have been made here. Jeff Beck, everybody that was known for a Fender guitar from 1953 to 85, they were all done here. And then in 85, I think CBS owned Fender, and some of the employees had somehow bought back part of the stock, and they ended up moving it. Now it's out in Corona, and that's where it's been ever since. But I just thought this was so cool to know that this whole structure right here is where all those guitars, that's why, you know, like I said, when I found that free guitar out in my lobby that day, the whole reason I picked it up was just because it was a Fender. It just brought back memories of being in Troy, Ohio, working at Sound City Music, and just always seeing, you know, we would always get demonstrations and get promotional material from Fender. And it was just, it's one of the most important companies in music instrument production there is, there ever will be. And, you know, besides Gibson, Fender is the number one. What is going on over there? There's a guy set up with a drum set on the side of the sidewalk. Just going John Bonham. Well, we drove by this and now we are going into this. Okay, so every year Breck and his friends have a Secret Santa gift exchange. And one of his friends put in these old mailbox doors from like a post office, and just knowing that Breck or somebody would make something out of them, and Breck has made something out of it. He made this weird box that you can basically open up the lid and charge your phone. He's got these little plugs built in there, and then there's like some main ones that come out of the back. Weird.
Nerd!
Totally.
Alright, we're here at Disney. We're gonna go see Aileen Quinn's band. She was the original little orphan nanny from the movie with Carol Burnett and Bernadette Peters.
Downtown Disney District with exciting shopping.
Legos, huh? I mean, I made some cool stuff with Legos when I was a kid, but nothing like this.
Yeah,
this is insanity. All right, we're here. It looks like she's playing the maracas and singing right now. The birds are going crazy. The Guardian of the Galaxy is really taking shape over the Tower of Terror over here. So what we decided to do is that since Breck works at Disneyland and he has all these like guest passes that he never uses all of, and my favorite dessert, the pecan roll, is here at Disneyland, in between sets for the band, we decided to waste 3 guest passes so that I could come in and try and get this. Now the funny thing is that the last couple times I've tried to get this, they've been sold out. So I was telling Breck as we walked in, I said, it'd be really funny if they're out of it and you blew about $500 worth of guest passes for me to get a $6 piece of candy. So we'll see what happens. Don't worry guys, I am not gonna do a whole Disney vlog. The last thing in the world the YouTube universe needs is more Disney vlogs. I'm here for the candy and to get out. Oh, and I want to go by Steve Martin's Magic Shop because I want to show you guys something. I always point it out when I'm here, but I actually found a picture of him working in there at the register. So I'm going to show you that and then match it up.
Excuse me.
So the picture I have is him working right here. And speak of the devil. Hello. Now here's their Houdini display, and there's the Certificate of Authenticity, and it's his water torture cell. Let's see. Kind of cool. On to the mission at hand. Sea of people. It does look cool, though. Looks like they are sold out.
Again.
Caramel apples in the process.
I want to stay with you. I want you to meet me. I have to feel you. Come here and take me. Baby, to town. Baby wants to do nothing. Just can't.
Rockin' out, listen to a little game, so just down when he dances, I can hardly breathe. Someone call the doctor, I need some help to rescue me. One second I'm thinking I must be lost, but he keeps on finding me. That man is like a flame, that man plays it on your game. Only seen is like a dream. Do I wanna love that man? Do that man is on my list.
You want more?
Oh, yeah.
Call me back at Riverside 4238.
Ooh, ooh, I wanna love that man.
Ciao, ciao.
Set my foot, set my name all over the place. Do anything that you wanna do. Oh, for totally all the things you don't do. Seven blue sweat shoes. Dreams are on the face, but they all my blue sweat shoes.
Classic kids movie of all time. What was that like? How did you become Annie, and what was the cast like to you being such a young?
Lots of auditions. I had 8 auditions over a 1-year period, which a lot of people don't know. So it wasn't just right away, and I was in shock when I got the part. I didn't know that I had it. So
you seem like a seasoned professional in the movie. How did they treat you? How did Carol Burnett and Tim Curry?
You know,
Tim
what was
Curry
really nice
everybody?
About it was they were really more like family. Like, Carol Burnett was so protective of me. Like, she just took me under her wing and made sure I got my education when I'd like at school hours, and she would do speak and spell with me. She was great.
Really?
Albert Finney was funny, and in between takes when the cameras were being so slow, he would like tickle me under the knee. Like, it was really cute.
Oh, that's
like family.
So awesome.
Yeah.
How did you transition into what you're doing now? You have a big band, like a swing band.
Yes. Yeah, rockabilly, swing, and a little bit of blues. And I just really liked the women of rockabilly. I saw a special on the women, like, from the 50s and 60s, and I just really liked it. And I love when ladies got dressed up. Of course, I'm on my 4th set tonight, so I'm a little sweaty. But
you look great.
Thank you. But, yeah, I really liked the way they did their makeup, and they were dancing with gentlemen. I just thought it was so nice. And I was like, I want to do that. And here we are 4 or 5 years later, and we are Haley Quinn of the Leap the Lizards.
Did you ever lose the interest in performing music throughout the years?
No, and actually what a lot of people don't know is I've actually been nonstop in musical theater before.
That's
I went to LA and found my band for 25 years.
And you still
on Broadway
still do,
on national tours.
Do you still do musical theater, or do you take
well,
a break?
Well, I kind of am doing the band right now, but that's if I'm not ruling it out.
Thank you so much for
Thank
being
you.
On here.
Nice
You're
to meet
the best.
You.
Yeah. Hey, Lionhearts. So I wanted to end the vlog tonight by just saying one thing. You know, I every day I try and bring you something that's interesting or someone that's interesting or inspiring in the world that I think is worth talking about. And the day that this vlog comes out is no exception. Today is my grandpa's birthday. And I don't think anybody's ever inspired me as much as he does in the world. He's a good guy to everybody around him. And if there's ever a person that you can depend on, it's him. And to be perfectly honest, without him, there wouldn't be a vlog. From the time I was a little squirt and I would go on hikes with him or car rides with him. Everything that he drove by, he had a story about it. He either knew somebody that lived there, had something that happened, and he always had a story to tell. And I think that's what kind of inspired me to do vlogging. I just, whenever I drive around with people, I always am telling stories. And people just told me, like, you're a good storyteller one day. And I started doing this vlog without having any idea what I was doing, where it was going to really go. I just thought to myself, well, maybe I'll try and do it every day. But I didn't really think it would last that long. And what kept me going was that somewhere around the seventh day, I got an email from my grandpa. And I didn't even know he was watching the vlogs. And his email basically said, I don't know what a vlog is, but whatever these videos are that you're making, I like them. He said, you take me to places that I'll probably never get to see myself, and you have a story behind them. And I think that's pretty interesting. Plus, I get to see my grandson every day. And he did it early enough in my vlogging that it just stuck out in my head, and I just thought, well, if he likes it, maybe there's something to it. And as long as he's watching it, I'll keep doing them. And I know he watches every day, and since today's his birthday, I wanted to wish him a very happy birthday. You're the best, Papaw. For me and Ja, and I think everybody that watched this vlog, I think we all owe you a big thank you. So thank you very much, and I hope you have a very happy birthday. Good night.